جهولا ليعذب الله المنافقين والمنافقات والمشركين والمشركات ويتوب الله على المؤمنين والمؤمنات وكان الله غفورا رحيما صدق الله العظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اذكروني أذكركم واشكروني ولا تكفرون. وقال تعالى ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون. صدق الله العظيم. Dear respected brothers and sisters who are listening, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We made a big sacrifice to come here Sunday evening, Easter time as well. We could have made journey anywhere else. Alhamdulillah, and a lot of youngsters here as well. And I thank the committee members, I thank the brothers, the Maulanas, who made the effort as well to make this happen. My brothers and my sisters, right now you've all got friends. And your friends are your friends because there's things you like about them. And there's things that you have common that you share with them. And those friends are friends because when you speak, they like the same things you speak about. So if you're into football, they're into football as well. If you're into the gadgets, they're into some gadgets as well. You click together and you have a common understanding between yourselves. If you like a certain type of food, they like the same type of food. I mean, all of you like chicken and chips anyway. There's no going about that. But the thing is, you have many things that you have common that you share between yourselves. And then what happens is, your friends are your friends because there's loyalty. You have things that you share, many conversations you've had. It's not one day friend. These are weeks and months and years of friends. And the longer the friendship gets, the better it gets. Because you share things together. You share secrets together. And then you start doing favors for each other. And it gets to the stage where if your friend is going to need something, you're going to try and give him and try to support him. And that's how you see your friend, because he's close to you. Now brothers and sisters, imagine you've got friends. And the friend that you helped, that you gave, you know, favors to, that he needed something from you, as you gave it to him. He maybe needed some money, you just gave him some money. He maybe needed to have a ride, you gave him a ride, or whatever it was, back of your bike, whatever it might be. Whatever it was, you shared many things. You played so many games together. You spent so many nights together. If one day you're in trouble, if one day you need your friend to come and back you up, and that day your friend kind of makes excuses, you know, he's not in the mood of coming back to the house. You're saying, listen, guy, I need you, man. He's saying, what do you need me for, man? What do you need me for? Listen, I need you, man. What do you need me for? I need a favor. You know, I got homework, I need you to come down, bro. I need you tonight, you understand? Then, you know, my mum's like alone in the house and this guy, mum alone in the house, he was out all night with you, or he was out all day, he didn't care about mum and dad or whatever. Now he's saying his mum's alone in the house. Now how are you going to feel about that? You're going to feel what? Today he takes his mum's name. And now all those favors I did for him today, he recognized, you know, he's making silly excuses. Is it going to bother you or not bother you, yes or no? Is it going to bother you, yes or no? Yes, it's going to bother you. The reason why it's going to bother you is because it hurts you that all these years of friendship, and the day I need him or I want him, he doesn't come to me. Now, you're going to see him the next time around. You're going to say, hey, listen, man, listen. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? I was in trouble and I called you. I said, nah man, I couldn't come out. I'm asking you, man, as a friend to come. You can't come to a friend. Nah, it's alright, man, it's alright. Now he does that once to you. Right? He does that once too. Then imagine a second time he lets you down. You're going to feel worse. A third time he lets you down, you're going to start questioning your friendship. A fourth time he lets you down, you're going to start thinking seriously, quitting this friendship. You're going to see him next time say, what's up with you, man? Every time I need you, you're not there for me. Every time I'm there for you, you're not there for me. What kind of friendship is this? Now you're going to get cheesed off. What kind of friend are you? I don't care about you. You know what? You might as well stay in your quarters when you want. You don't care about that person. Now, la ilaha illallah, that's you as a person who had a friend maybe for 3 years, who used to do a few favors for your friend. And these are few favors, these are few days here and there you spent with your friend. Have you forgotten, my friend, that your mother, your father spent for you a whole 15 years, 20 years, 10 years, 12 years, 17 years, 24 years. Your mother and father gave unconditional love to you. And today, when your mother, after what, tell me, that friend, you did a few favors for him. You gave him some chicken and chips. You made him happy here and there, right? You played a few games with him. You shared all your football comments with him. You were on Facebook with that friend. That's fine. Your mother, when you were ill, she became mentally ill. When you suffered, she cried. She cried from here, brother. She cried from her heart. You know, when you were someone who was in need of food, she felt the hunger. She fed you first. She made sure that you ate while she went hungry. Your dad, when he had sweat coming from his head, just to bring the few pounds at home and feed his family, he strained his hands to carry the shopping home. And not one day, my friend. Your dad and your mom have been around the clock for not one day, not one week, not few months. They've been doing it continuously without failure for 15, 20 years. And they've given you everything you could not. You haven't even asked for these things. What have they given you? They gave you a good upbringing. They gave you a life. They gave you all your clothes. You know, each time you grow, brother, you know, if they stopped giving you clothes, you'd be, you know, your trousers when you were 4 years old, if they made you wear them when you're 8, you'd be wearing pants now, brother. Your trousers are growing every single 6 months, 4 months, 10 months. They have to buy you new trousers, new shirts, new vests, new tops. And they do it without complaining. They buy you 4 sets, 5 sets, 6 sets, one for wedding, one for this. They buy you a few shoes. They buy you all the different things that you might need for school. You're running out of, you know, uniform in school. They buy it again for you. You need tuition. They go out there. They spend £25 an hour, £20 an hour to try and get a private tutor just to teach you something. Teach you English. You know English you use? Now you're thinking, well, what does mom know? What does dad know? What do they know? They don't know. They don't know how to speak like me. Well, who taught you, my friend? It was your mom. It was your dad. Your mom spent the nights and the days of work thinking about you. She, even if she didn't put you in private tuition, she took over. She looked after the whole of your house. Without the whole house being maintained, your dad couldn't have done what he did. Your dad spends money after money. He's not caring about himself. You know, there comes a point when a dad and mom, they don't care about their own clothes. Whatever they've got, they wear what they've got. And they spend pounds and pounds, hundreds and thousands of pounds for just that you can get a good education. So you pass your GCSEs or whatever. Then, you know, before that or after that, you want your mobile phone. So they gave you that. You wanted your PS1, they had that, PS2, you had that, PS3, you had that, now PS4 comes out. Dad, PS4, PS4, PS4. You got PS3, PS4, PS4, PS4. They're kind of saying after me, what? Okay, I'll give you PS4. You just got it. You got it. You wanted the latest Game Boy, whatever, you got it. You wanted latest technology, you just got it. You wanted internet, you got it. You wanted a computer in your bedroom, you got it. You wanted an extra TV somewhere, you got it. You got whatever you got. I don't care if some of you haven't got these things. You must have got some of these things. And you asked for it, you just got it. And especially the Bengali culture, we've got a habit of spoiling our kids. Acha, khelila. You let him play, it's alright. Yeah. Whatever it is, you've got a habit of knowing that you can get what you want. Now you got all of that. Then you have friends. You suddenly have friends. Then you go out to college, or you're at the end of maybe from 12 to 16. See, what happens at a kid at 12 years old is they go through a stage where Allah Azza wa Jal now gives them the ability to become a young man. A young man. So what happens is that he was fichibacha, he was a little kid, right? You know, like if you squeeze him, his mom's milk is going to come out of his mouth, right? Suddenly, he gets to 12 years old, and now he's got shot up 1 foot in 1 year. Allahu Akbar. He's growing. Before he used to eat a little bit, and he's full. Now he's eating 2-3 plates. Allah's given him good growth. And where does the plate come from? His mom and dad gets it for him, right? And he has it on his plate. Yeah? 3-4 curries or whatever, he's stuffing it all down. He's not buying it, he's not cooking it, he's not getting it, he's just on the plate, so he eats it. His Adam's apple pops out. Yeah? He was speaking like, "Hello, how are you?" before him.
"Hello, how are you?"
Suddenly his voice is broken. He's got deep voice now. And now, you know what? Before, when he used to see his muscles, they used to go downwards. Now they go up. You know, yes, because of muscles. So he started looking at himself in the mirror. Yeah. And then he swear that he gets a cold and starts flicking his head. Man. And all he cares about is, you know what? I'm the biggest, the best, the baddest boy out there. Because Allah gave him the muscles, Allah gave him the hair, Allah through his mom and dad gave him the food in his body, Allah gave him all those clothes through his mother and father, and he thinks he's it. Now he don't care. Now like before, his mom used to come and say, Ji Amma, come straight down. Now his mom calls him to Airam, coming. Airam, coming. Now he spends time, man. You know, like the kid, when he needed his mom before, right? And even now his mom's there for him. His dad's there for him. Now he starts delaying. And when he comes like, you know, doom, doom, doom.
What are you?
Just go to the shop and just give me this. Oh, you have to go right now, this time. Because the thing is, he's got a phone in his hand, see? He's in the middle of texting. See? He's got like some buddies that are, you know, on a group, WhatsApp group, you know, and the WhatsApp, you know what WhatsApp is? WhatsApp is a cheap man's way of contacting one another. It's a cheap man's way, seriously. You know, all these guys that got WhatsApp, I see them as lowlifers. I got WhatsApp as well, but I'm not a lowlifer. Because I don't prefer to use it. I prefer you to use text because text costs you money. And all these other guys that WhatsApp us, they get 50 messages a day. Magana Fidi, Mufata. It's free, isn't it? So you just send as much as you want. All day, just send it. So the thing is, he's on WhatsApp and sending all these free messages, and he ain't got time for his mom. His mom wants him to go to the shop and get him something, so, you know, he makes excuses. I'll go, I'll do it. This, I'll that. Nah! Your mom, when you cry, or when you need something, your mom was there like lightning. She was just there. Didn't your mom do that? Didn't your mom stroke you? Didn't your mom just put her hand on your leg when you hurt it and just massage you for a little while? Did your mom not drop all her cooking for you? Did she not drop all the everything in the household for you? And now today you got a phone in your hand. I'm going. And forget that. Now after a while he gets into with his buddies, he gets into weight training, he gets into football. His mates now, they dictate his life. His mom is second. His dad is second. And he has forgotten his roots. He's forgotten his real people who love him. Boys, girls, I want you to listen to me, right? You know, all your friends put together, all of them put together. You put all their love for you put together. it's not going to be even 1/10 of the love or not 1/70 of the love that your mother has for you. Why? If you were in a building and the building was on fire, you think your mates are going to jump inside to save you? Put your hands up. If the building's literally on fire, blazing, and you happen to be inside, you're in the middle, your friends are outside, and they know that, you know, their friend, Mo, his name is Muhammad, calls himself Mo, they know Mo's inside. So they're going to get Mo, he's inside. Hey man, Mo's burning. Hey man, Mo's burning. Oh man, sad innit? Sad innit? Got burned innit? That's what they're going to say, bruv. Nah man, bruv, don't go there, man. Nah man, you got there, you're going to get burned as well, bruv. You're going to come back like a burnt kebab, bruv. Now Mo's in there. You're not getting like Mo. If your mom was outside that building, she will not talk, she will jump, she will leap. She don't care how many burns she's going to have on her body. She don't care she becomes shaheed that day. She will go in there, guaranteed. She don't care, she dies before she sees your body. But she will jump and she will not think. She'll try and grab you from inside and take you out. Yes or no, Tommy?
Yes.
And you forget who loves you. You forget where the real love is. Your mates don't even care. See, your mates, your friends, all that your friends for is taking the mick out of you half the time. That's what it is. You support Arsenal, he supports Chelsea. You had 6-0, he got hammered. The other day it was 6-0, wasn't it? Chelsea versus Arsenal, yeah? Now what's going to happen? Your mates that support Chelsea, they're going to come, hey, what's the matter, man? Hey, are you having that egg? Hey, I'm the egg. I heard you scored egg today. Egg. You know? Heard you got Dimbo. You know Dimbo? They're going to take the mick. They're going to ravish you. That's all it is. And you're going to be trying to hide it. And the next thing, you got one over there, you got one over there. Your mates, what do they care about? Your mates care about their ego. If you care about their ego, they care about your ego. Fine, brother. They find a girl, you find a girl, you get together, that's fine. We're on the same boat. They don't care about Akhirah. Half the times, they don't care about your future. They don't care you're going to muck your exams. Tell me this, yeah? Your mates are the very reason why you mess your exams up. Not your mom, not your dad. Your dad's doing their best for you to pass your exams. Your mom's doing their best for you to pass your exams. Your ego, your inside, your phone, your technology, your mates, your friends, they are the reason you muck your exams. And don't tell me otherwise, okay? Spending too much time with them, having fun with them, playing games with them, chatting with them, online chats. And especially if you see a person who, you know, shaitan, you know what shaitan does? You see one person that, you know, you shouldn't have been looking at. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Sahmun min sihari shaitan." Shaitan is sitting there with a bow and some arrows. You know, have you seen those love hearts with an arrow inside you? Yeah? Rasulullah said, Shaitan is sitting with some arrows. So what he does is, he wants you to look. And when you look, he goes, bah, 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 right in your heart. Look again. Look again. Look again. That's what he's going to say. Look again. First few times, astaghfirullah. First few times, astaghfirullah. Next few times, inshallah. The man's head switches. Seriously. Because shaitan has put some time. Now, forget mom, forget dad. He don't even know his friends. His friends call him, you know, come on. Nah, man, I got it, alright. The guy's getting called Jenny and Bobby now. He don't even know his friends. And then he goes next, and now he knows her, he goes forward, then he says, him and her. That's all it is about. Him and her. If I can get married to that girl there, then me, my whole world, everything disappears. You think this is some kind of fairy tale, my friend? and they lived happily ever after. And they lived happily. Do you think that exists in the real world? You know why they're doing all of this? Because you know her, she's a spoiled brat as well. She is a spoiled brat. He's a spoiled brat. She forgot her roots, her mom and dad. He forgot his roots, mom and dad. She gets fed every single day. He gets fed every single day free. She gets a mattress to go and sleep on every night free of charge in her dad's house. He's got a free mattress in his house free of charge every single day. She gets, you know, all the shower, cooking, ironing, everything done over there in her house. He gets the same thing. So when they come out, it's like all they come out is for his fun. That's it, they just come out for fun. What they don't realize is the real life is marriage. Once they get married, see, they don't have all of that. You know why? Because marriage is not just about fun, my friend. Marriage is responsibility. Life is about responsibility. All these years, mom and dad did everything for them, and they went through their life as if nothing was going to come and spoil their life. And you know the thing that hurts most is the mom is back home. She's wondering, yalla, kum shoma ibo, yalla, kum shoma ibo, yalla. She can't sleep, brother. You know, you're out, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. She's not sleeping until you come home. She will stay awake. She will have your food ready. And even when you come home, you know the real person that loved you is your mom. And she comes and she says, you know, son, I told you, futra fut khuilam refut. Takhul is not a fut. Khotahun refut. Listen to me, your son. Don't do it, son. Don't do it. You know, she's giving you still her love. She'll still feed you one in the night. Khailara fut. Gorom khori dimune. I'll warm it up for you. Just eat. You know, you messed her up. You didn't even do the shopping, she told you. You went out and enjoyed it with your friends all evening. She didn't hold anything against you. You know what real love is, my friend? That's real love. Because what's going to happen to you one day, my friend, is one day that mom of yours, that amma of yours, that mama of yours, that ammiji of yours, one day she's not going to be there to call you foot anymore. And when that day comes, you're going to regret the fact that you messed up so badly. You'll be crying, but you don't know whether your mom can ever know of your tears coming out. And the hurt that you cause yourself is going to be the greatest pain in your body. Even if you've been good to your mom, when you lose your mom, there's nothing worse than that. I'm going to give you a quick stat. Watch this here. How many of you are in this crowd? Maybe I'm just talking to a few people here who've lost both their mothers and fathers. Put your hands up. If you lost your mom, then just keep your hands up. Now keep your hands up if the hurt you had in your heart was more deeper when your mom went as opposed to your dad. Keep your hands. If it hurt you more, your mom. Look, no hand goes down. No hand goes down. Now put your hands down. It kills, bro. I lost my mom. I lost my father. When I lost my father, it was a big loss. And when I lost my mother, there was nothing to compare it with. Because you lost the person you spent 9 months inside her womb, inside her body. You just lost the person who could cut her heart out for you if she wanted to keep you happy. If she had to, she would do that. If someone came to harm you and said to your mother, you either cut your heart or your liver out for your kid back, or you're not going to see your heart, your kid back, she would do it. She'll kill herself. She would be ready to kill herself to see you alive. And for your friends, you forgot your mom. You forgot who really loved you? But bro, sister, the day you lose your mother, you're going to find out the value of your mother, and that's too late. I want to take you to a next level. Now, first I started with friends. Then I started with, you know, family, mother. Then I started with a person meeting the right spouse, the right girlfriend in his life, right? And brother, all this life, sister, all this life has gone by. Can you imagine? Can you now imagine? The one who was above your mother and your father loved you more than your mother. Now who's going to love you more than my mother? My mother gave me everything. My mother cared for me. She'd rip her heart out for me if she had to. Who's going to love me more than that? Allahu Akbar. My friend, the fact that you breathe, who gave you the power to breathe? Take his name. Take his name. Now let me count. Who gives you the power to see? Take his name. To hear. To smell. To touch. To walk. To have feelings. Who gives you 3 times meal a day for your entire life? Who gives you water in this country where we are? Water available anywhere you want. Who gives that to you? Who gives you sleep at night? Who gives you rest when you sleep and you slept, you woke up, you have rest? Who gives you that? Who gives you your risk and your provision in the day? Allah. Who gives you the brain cells to know what you're reading? Take his name. Who gives the ability to speak? Who makes you move your hands when you want to make your text message? Who? Who gives you your friends? Who makes you be a person who's admired by friends? Who? Who gave you a hair on your head that you comb every single day? Who gave you muscles on your body that you start looking at yourself and admire yourself in the mirror? Who?
Allah.
Who gave you the ability to go and to not see the doctor for 2 years, 3 years? You didn't even visit the doctor. Who gave you the ability?
Allah.
You never got sick. You never had no toothache. You never had no headache. You never had no backache. You never had no legache. You never had no muscle ache. You never had no knee ache, you never had no hip ache, you never had no contraction muscles, you never had a problem with digesting your food. Who gave you that for years? Who?
Allah.
Allah. Allah. Take his name again.
Allah.
Allah. Who is the one that wakes you up every morning?
Allah.
Allah. Who makes you travel on the ground without you having an accident?
Allah.
Allah. Who makes you the one who 6 months before today's day, 6 months, he planned that rice that was for you today is going to come to my servant. So Allah wrote on this rice, Ibrahim is going to eat that. And that rice, Muhammad is going to eat that. That one, Ishaq is going to have it. And that one, Zayn is going to have it. And that one, Fatima is going to have it. Who wrote the name on each single grain? And all those grains, no matter how they go into the sack, they end up on your plate. Who gave you that tawfiq? Take his name.
Allah.
And when you, who gave you the teeth to have your food? Say
Allah.
Who gave you the tongue that has the taste of your food? Say
Allah.
Who gives you the ability to swallow your food without choking?
Allah.
And who digests your food for you while you roam around disobeying him, not praying, not thinking of him, not caring for what he said to you? Who gives you the ability for you to digest all your food without any complaint? Take his name.
Allah.
You see, go to the hospital, you see people with bags outside, urine bags outside, you know, because the bladder is not working, because the kidney has failed. They have to have bags. Who gives you automatic without you having to go and oil yourself? Your joints, they work every single day without failure. Who gives you that?
Allah.
Who gives you ability to run, to smile? Allah. Allah. Who gave you a family? Allah. Who gave you a roof over your head? Allah. Who keeps you safe from the weather? Allah. Who is the one that loves you more than any other creature in the whole of his existence? What's his name? Say
Allah.
Can you imagine that after Allah gave you everything you have become, your education, the language, the skills, the quick thinking, the smartness, you know, the Muslim 2.0, next generation, gadgets to understand it, to know how to use the devices, to become someone who's so smart, who's so slick, who's so brilliant, is that, you know what, I'm the one, you give me a gadget, I'll work it out like anything. Who gave you that? Allah. Allah. Who gives you a job? Allah. Who brings you salary at the day, end of the day? Allah. Who makes a woman love you? Who makes that?
Allah.
My friend, you could have been so ugly that you no woman would have ever taken it. You could have been ugly with a big Y. Seriously, you could have. Who gave you? The fact that even, you know, some people, the funny thing is, some people are really handsome. Some men are really handsome. And you think, you know what? That guy, Allah, that guy has got no problem in finding his path. No problem at all. And then, you know what happens? Everyone else gets married. But the handsome guy, the charming guy, He's 30 plus, he's still not married. Everybody can do this with it. And that was happened, man. How come? You know, he's still charming. You know, he's got that face. You look at him, you think, man, wish I had a face like that. That guy is seriously charming. But he's still not married. You know why? Because he becomes too picky. Too picky. You know, the girls are after him. Not you. Not you. All is that, not you. You, yes, you. And the one he goes for, that one doesn't want him. The one he goes for, that one Allah never put Muhammad in her heart for him. He's messed up, bro. Because he has so much love for this one. There's 50 others after him. 50 others is a high school whore. High school young. Today I get married. I forget anything. I'll get married unconditional today. There's 50 after him. But the one he falls for, Allah doesn't put love in her heart. He's messed up. He goes after for years and years and years and years. Manila. Accept him, please accept him. In the end, what happens is, you know, she gets married to some other bloke. He's like, duh. It's now 32, 33. Now the women, the rest of the 59, he goes for the 49, the 50, 49. He goes for the, hey, don't run away from me. Don't want you now. He messed up big time. You think that you're handsome, just because you're handsome, people are just going to fall for you, and you're going to fall for them? Nah. Your mahabba, your love, and her love to come at the same time, and for you to get married together is from who?
Allah.
From Allah. Your money, you know, you made business. You just made some business. Do you think that, yahta kulichi soligese? Oila, kita gabna. Now I'm a big man. You think it just happened like that? You think you become a big boss, you just happen like that? For every customer to come to you, who makes the customers come? Allah. Some people, I tell you, they make their best shops, their best place, the best decor, the best chef. And they try to, honestly, I've got a friend in Surrey. The guy's made the, he has spent 50,000 in shop. He's got everything, you know, done. And what did he mess up on? He spent so much money, he's got an area, he's got car park, he's got everything. People come by, they stop by. But they don't come a second time now. You know why? Because one time, you know what he hasn't got? He's got everything. He's got money, he's got everything. What hasn't he got? He hasn't got the right team. He just couldn't get the right team together. You think you just happen to get the right team? Who gives you that team?
Allah.
He's got the chef, but you know his waiters? You know, by the time they bring it, this and that is cold, bad service, this and that, maktab, it doesn't work. Or sometimes you don't find the right shape, sometimes you don't find the right place, sometimes you don't find the right thing that will make everything work. You need Allah to make it work. You can't just do it yourself. And then for you to have children, from Allah. For you to have children that bring you happiness to you, Allah. For you to be able to go through life without worry, Allah is the one that does that. Every day, every moment, Allah says what?
Kulla yawmin huwa fi sha'n. Every day, Allah Azza wa Jalla is in a moral duty to look after you. Allah has got a moral duty to look after you. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. O you who believe. اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا. Remember me plentifully. Why should you remember Allah? Allah says, وجعلنا, and I made for these people, لكم السمع, I gave you hearing, ولا بصارة, I gave you the sight, ولا فداء, I gave you the minds. Brother, without these three things, you are mashed. You're in a hospital. You're in a blind institute. You're in a deaf institute. You're paralyzed in a wheelchair. You've been paralyzed in a wheelchair. You've seen deaf people. You've seen blind people. Allah's made three things work. Mind with the heart. Eyes that see, ears that listen, and a mind that processes the information. First thing is the ears. You have to hear hearing. You might think sight is more. No. Hearing is more important. Allah mentioned hearing first. Why? Because those people who are blind, they don't have an impeachment in their speech. Those people who are deaf, they're impeached in their speech. Yes or no? They have a problem with their speech. They can't say the words properly. You know why? Because once their hearing is affected, they haven't registered those words clearly in their mind. They haven't registered it. You might have said, say, I don't know, say household, just say household. They might have heard out-oh. That's what they heard, because their hearing is impeded. Now they can't communicate. That one's affected, this one's affected. Allah may go free way for you, brother. And the person who has been affected, don't take the mick out of it. Anyone who's got a problem in life, someone's got an eye that's squinting. Somebody who's got, you know, somebody who's got a beard that looks funny. Somebody who's got a crooked walk. Don't laugh at them. Rasulullah has told us, he's told us, you say this, Alhamdulillahilladhi, Alhamdulillahilladhi, عافاني مما ابتلاك به وفضلني على كثير مما خلق تفضيلا. What you're saying is, all praise to Allah who has saved me from what He has tested you with. He has exempted me from the test He put you through. وفضلني, and He has given me great, great bounties over many of His creation. Doesn't matter how bad you're feeling, brother, how bad you're feeling, sister, you are still a lot luckier than many of Allah's creation outside there. So the thing is, Allah makes all three for you. Why should you worship Allah? Why? Why? Allah says what? Allah Akbar. هُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمْ Allah makes for you. الْأَرْضَ ذَلُولًا I have made the earth for you that you can walk without the earth shaking underneath you. Allah هُوَ الَّذِي He is the one. جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الشَّمْسَ عَلَيْهِ دَلِيلًا Allah is giving you the sun. Bright sun, warmth that comes to you, you enjoy that. Allah says, جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَنْعَامَ لِتَأْكُلُوا مِنْهَا I've given you animals from which you have your meat. You know your kebabs? You know your burgers that you love? Your burgers? Where are you going to get your burgers, bruv, if all the animals are dead? Where are you going to get them from? لَكُمْ فِيهَا دِفْءٌ وَمَنَافِعُ وَمِنْهَا تَأْكُلُونَ You take warmth from these animals. You have many different benefits in these animals. And I give that all to you. Allah says what? هُوَ الَّذِي He is the one. خَلَقَ لَكُم مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا I created from yourself your spouse that is supposed to be for you. I created you from yourself. Allah says, وَجَعَلَ لَكُمْ أَنَا He has made for you. بَنِينَ Children that you have Allah's made children, grandchildren. Where did that come from? Come from Allah's with them. هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ مِنَ الْمَاءِ بَشَرًا Allah has created from water, just from water He has created human beings. هُوَ الَّذِي ذَرَأَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ He is the one that spread you on the earth like this. Who spread us like this? Allah spread us on the earth like this. We have communication. Who creates that? Allah. Allah says that. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ From His signs are what? اِخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ I make you talk different languages. That's for my sign. I make you have dreams in the daytime. مَنَامُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ Dreams in the night, dreams in the day. I give you those things. Allahu Akbar. هُوَ الَّذِي He is the one. جَعَلَ لَكُمْ He is the one who's made what? He's made the sama بِنَاءَ He's made the sky that protects us. He's given us food, earth, water, everything we need. Allah said what? سَخَّرَ لَكُمُ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرِ The sun is serving you, the moon is serving you. Creates time for you. And it's doing many things for you. You think your life is great without these things around you? Allahu Akbar. You know, even in a country like this, where we have a lot of rain, say Alhamdulillah. Say Alhamdulillah. Don't you think that this is not a gift of Allah? We have less sun here, but it's still Alhamdulillah. You go to a country, you know, you spend... I had a friend come from Dubai a few years back. Friend came from Dubai. It was like an evening in May, 7 p.m. The wind's blowing strong. Wind's blowing strong and the rain is drizzling. And he's standing outside with us. His hand is chapped. First, it wasn't raining. So he's standing outside, shirt open on the top. And the wind's blowing. And I'm like shivering. And another guy next to me was shivering, right? And he's chatting and we said, should we not just go inside? He goes, this is Alhamdulillah. This is brilliant. This is brilliant. I'm thinking, brilliant? What's up with him, man? Brilliant? And And the wind is blowing and it's cold and it's chilly and he's loving it. He's got his shirt top open and it's going through his whole shirt and the drizzle is coming and he says, Alhamdulillah. That's me and my friend saying, La hawla wa la quwwata. Let's get inside, bro. Yeah? So he tried to convince him and he said, you don't know what this is, guys. He said, in Dubai, he said, at this time, he said, you can't walk out the house. You get burnt. You can't stand outside. You just can't physically stand outside. You will start getting headaches. You will start getting knocked out because of the 48 degrees, 50 degrees heat. He's in that. Then he comes here, he sees the wind, he says, Alhamdulillah. Me and you are thinking, we want the sun, we want the sun, we want the sun. You don't know what ni'mah we've got. You don't know. You know those countries, hot countries? They can't work between 2 o'clock to about 4 o'clock. They stop working. It's too hot for them to work unless they're working under AC. They can't work. Physically, they'll be dead if they work. And what Allah has given to us is subhanAllah. And He gives that. And He gives more. And subhanAllah, you miss your Isha. You miss your Fajr. And Allah says, hear my servant, eat again. You miss your dhuhr, you miss your asr, Allah says, my servant, have a snack again. You miss your no dhikr, no Allah in your life, no messenger in your life, nothing is that. And Allah says, here my friend, here you are, my servant, here from your friend, I'm going to make him give you a gift. And I'm going to give you one mess, I'm going to give you clothes, I'm going to give your father give you money, I'm going to give you education, and I'm going to give you brilliancy in life, and I'm going to give you intelligence, and I'm going to give you all those people around you, and I'm going to give you all those attention, everything around you, my servant, you're still my servant, I have got unconditional love for you. Just like your mom, me and mom, she'll do anything for you, Allah will do anything for you. Hasn't He done anything for you? Allah says what? Allah says, أَمَّنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Who else is the one that created the heaven and the earth? Who is the one that when you were in need and you cried to Allah, you cried to Allah, you said, oh Allah, help me at this moment. Allah says, who is the one besides me that took you out of that mess? Tell me if there's anyone here who's above the age of 15, who once in their life, any moment, you know, once, I don't care which moment you're in life, you're above 15, once in your life, you desperately called to Allah, and Allah answered your call. Put your hands up if Allah did that for you even once. Hands up, hands up. Look at this, brother, look at this. There's about 50 hands here. Keep your hands up if it was twice. Keep your hands up if it was three times. Keep your hands up if four times. Keep your hands up five times. Keep your hands up six times. Look, hands are not going down. Seven times, eight times, nine times, then Allah. Allah. And that Allah you forgot. That Allah you forgot. If Allah wanted you to go through the night restless, you'd be mashed in the morning. Forget exam, you'd be mashed. Some people, they get restless, they got too much worry. And the worry keeps them awake. If Allah wanted, in the daytime you could go out there and you could do what you like. I'll give you an example. There's two fishermen. Right? Once it's here, and once it's where the Imam Sahib is. Right? Two fishermen. Both come out early in the morning. Both out there 6 a.m. in the morning. Both got the same rod. So Imam Sahib's got the same rod, and I've got the same rod. We're both at the same pond. We're just 2 meters or 1.5 meters apart. And they strike, and they put the little rod inside, and they're waiting. Boom! Imam Sahib gets a fish. I'm still waiting. He puts his rod on again. Here's another one. Must have made a big dua. So I'm still there, see? He's caught seven. I've caught one. So what do I do then? He says, I've never caught one. Move from there. You know, you're going to take all the fish? Let me go there. So Imam Sahib, you know, polite Imam Sahib, he says, okay, let me come to your place, you come to mine. Okay, fine, hey, come here. I'll go over there. And I put my rod, he puts his rod. Dong, his one comes out again. Hey, dong, his one comes out again. If Allah don't want to give you, bruv, you can go wherever you want. Who gives you?
Allah.
Allah. There's some dumb people in life. Allah has made them so rich. Yes or no?
Yes.
Some guys, they don't know what business is. I work for one of them once. That guy don't know from A to B to B to C. As in, he don't know, honestly, he don't know how to run his business. Seriously. I was working for him for a few months. And I'm thinking, how did this guy get 80 employees? Allah's just given him 80 employees. The guy's got tens and tens of thousands of pounds. The guy, you know, I'm being serious here. He's in his 100,000s of pounds. And the guy don't know how to run his business. And I was there with him for a little while. And what I did is, I helped him out quite a lot. And I pulled him up one day. I thought, that's enough. I'm going to ask this guy. The guy don't know if his money's falling out of his pocket. You know, some guys, you know, he had a little slip, his money fell, he don't even know where his money, he don't even bother. Some guy, other guy's picking his money and taking, he don't even know. Some guy's ripping it off, he don't even know that it's happening. So I pulled him up and I said, bro, I said, Allah's giving you so much money. I said, how did you make this business? How did you, because I can see that you don't know how to run this property. You know, he said to me, he said, I have a secret. I said, what's your secret? So he told me a secret. And it was a secret, so I can't tell you. So anyway, let's get on with the rest of the... He told me a secret. Am I supposed to tell you a secret? You know, the worst thing is, there's no such thing as secret. If you want to keep a secret, keep it to yourself. The moment you tell a person, it's going to go wrong. Especially if you tell women, she'll put some butter on it before she says it. She'll say to the next woman, she'll say, I'm not supposed to say this to you, but this happens. Don't tell anyone. Sealed. She'll go to the next one. I'm not supposed to tell you, but don't tell anyone. My God. Anyway, men are bad, but women are worse in this matter. Anyway, this is what was the secret. The secret was, he said to me, whenever a Muslim brother needs help, I've always helped him. And that's my secret. That's my secret. But when he said that to me, it struck one hadith. What is that hadith? Allahu fi auni al-abdi ma kana al-abdu fi auni akhihi. Allah will be at the service of his servant as long as his servant is helping his brother. Allah will be helping his servant as long as his servant is helping his own Muslim brother. That's the secret. And I saw him. You know what? Anyone came to him for anything, he gave. And he gave. He never said no to anyone. And Allah made this man, who was completely, got no clue of running his business, Allah gave him hundreds and thousands of pounds. Now he's doing business in the Middle East. He's left his country. He's doing business in the Middle East. He's making big bucks out there. Allahu Akbar. May Allah give him barakah in his life. He's helped a lot of brothers. A lot of brothers are helping. And you know what the other thing on top of that is? He never boasts about his health. Like if he's helped you, he won't tell this one that, you know what, I've helped him and I've helped him. No. So many have been helped, but only they know they've been helped. And he doesn't talk, he doesn't brag about it. But Allah, that's Allah Azza wa Jal. Now coming back to the point that I was trying to make to you brothers and sisters is, Allah Azza wa Jal has done so much, so much, so much for me. And I'm going to be so ungrateful. I eat of his table. I sleep on the bed provided. I enjoy the snoozes I get. I love the technology he's given me. I love the friends he gave me. I love the luxurious life he gave me. And in the midst of all of that, I'm not going to remember Allah for an hour a day. You're not going to do sujood to Allah. What did Allah ask you? And why did Allah tell you to do sujood? Why? There's a reason. Allah could have told me and you just to sit there and a few times say, you know, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. Or he could have told us to say Fatiha sitting down all the time. Alhamdulillah.
I said a surah sitting down. I make a dua. Allah said that could have been worship. Like, you know, the Christians have made their worship. You go into a church, you sit on a bench, you sing a few songs, you back out again, it's done. You say glory, hymns, Jesus, whatever, you sing, it's done, gone. Allah could have given us any ibadah He wanted. Why did Allah Azza wa Jalla make us do all the different ways? Why? Because my brother, Allah wants you to show Him real appreciation with God, with every part of your body. Oh Allah, I'm going to stand in front of you without moving, because my whole body owes this thanks to you. Oh Allah, I'm not going to chew even a chewing gum while I stand in front of you, because you've been so good to me. Oh Allah, you have been so good to me, I'm not even going to rock. I'm not going to look away. I'm just going to look down out of your awe and out of respect for you. Oh Allah, my eyes have given in to you. Oh Allah, my body is completely straight, completely in humiliation for your sake. And when you go into ruku, oh Allah, my back, my whole back. You know, brother, you know what your back is? Your back is the thing that makes you walk. Your spine's gone, you're finished. My spine, my back. Oh Allah, my whole back is in your service. You know why back? Because this part you can't see. This part you can't see. Whoever can see you from here is the one in control of you. Don't forget that. Allah sees you from here, from here, from here, from here, from here, from up, from down, from everywhere. When you get up and you go to sujood, oh Allah, the most beautiful part of my body, the part that I look after all the time, the part that I wash several times a day, the part that I will, you know, if it's a sister, I will make sure that it looks really good. If it's a brother even, I'll make it look really good. I'm putting that whole, the nose, the forehead, the palms, the knees, the feet on the ground, because I want to show you, I appreciate what you have given me. That's all it is. You know, in return, what Allah does for you, if you really appreciate, whether you have more in, it's not about you prayed and you get more in this world. No. Here, Allah gives to whoever He wants, however He wants. Enemy, friend, doesn't matter. He will give his enemy more if he wants, and the close one, He will give him less. Here is not where you measure it. Where you measure it is the next world. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَلِمَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ جَنَّتَانِ. The one who has fear for his Lord, Allah will give him two jannas. How many? Two jannas. Everybody has one jannah. If you fear Allah from this world, Allah will give you two jannas. Now the Mufassirun have said, what is two jannas? Allah will give you a jannah in the next world, the jannah that everyone will go to. But Allah will give you a jannah in this world as well. How's the jannah in this world? I don't have jannah. My house is still the boring stinky somehow. Hey, the wallpaper is coming all off. I can't fix it. How's the jannah? How's the jannah that I have all that pollution coming in my street? How's the jannah when I'm having struggles paying my bills? How's the jannah? No. For a mu'min, the jannah is what? For the mu'min, the jannah is here. Allah will give you the sweetness. Allah will give you pleasure. Allah will give you the ability to know that my Allah is with me when I want Him. That is jannah. My Allah is going to look after me. Why? I wasn't a servant who started to look here and there. I kept my eyes down for Allah's sake. Allah saw that Allah makes me have a sweetness in my heart. I was a servant that when I listen to something, I first assess whether it's halal, it's haram. And then if it's halal, I listen to it. If it's haram, I said, I'm not listening to it. I was a person who the tongue that I had, I use it for Allah's sake. I only speak the truth. I don't lie. I'm a person, when I'm in my world, I know my people, I know my roots. I look after the people whose I'm supposed to look after. When you do that, you know what happens? Allah Azza wa Jal will be there for you. How? You will see that Allah will make you comfortable. You know the comfort? The comfort, tamanina, you know, like being so relaxed.
that comfort, Allahu Akbar, it doesn't just come like that. It doesn't just come like that. For you to be in toil and stress, it doesn't come like that. Let me give you a story. And then you'll understand. They say that Mansur, who was a king, he had one of his sons, a prince. And the prince was in a palace in Baghdad. This is in the old times. So here he is in a massive palace on a hill. He's got all the guards protecting his palace. He's got all the servants within the palace to serve him. He clicks his finger and it just happens. He just calls to the servant and he's there. He's got all the food he wants, all the luxuries he wants. He's got all the pearls and diamonds, whatever he can wish for. It's all there. And what he does every day is he goes to his little arch of his window. And he looks down onto sunny Baghdad. And he looks down from the hill from his palace and he sees the whole bustling town. And he sees all these people are in toil every single day. That man's going there, this one's going there, that one's doing that. And they're all busy, 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 busy every day. And he enjoys sitting there and looking from the arch of his window down into the town and seeing people. Now you know when you sit there every single day and you see the same people, soon you start seeing patterns, yes? Soon you start noticing the same people doing the same thing. So he notices one man. This one man gets up after the sun rises, and this man gets up and he goes all the way and he finds some wood. He chops some wood, he comes all the way back to the town, and then he starts selling his wood. And then at mid-morning, the man goes to the side, he prays two rakat salatul duha. It's a mid-morning prayer, nafl prayer. Then after that, he goes and carries on selling wood until dhuhr time comes. He goes to the river that's running by. At the river he does his wudu, he comes all the way back to the shade, he cools himself down, has his wudu, and then back again he'll take a loaf of bread. Every day he's doing the same thing. A loaf of bread, he takes a few bites, and a bit of water he drinks, and then his arm becomes his pillow, he puts it underneath, and then he goes to rest in the shade and he has his siesta. And then the same man after an hour or so he gets up, he carries on selling his wood and so on till the dusk time, and then he's gone. Every day he sees this man doing the same thing over and over again. So one day what the prince says is, the prince calls his servants over. He says, hey listen, he says, you see that man over there? He says, yes. That man, I want you to call him to my palace. So they go all the way and they call that man into the palace of the prince. The prince has now got this poor man in front of him. He says, hey, why is it that you do what you do? I've been watching you from the arch. Every day you do the same thing. Why is it that you do what you do? So then he said, oh prince, he said, I have a mother and I have a sister. And all day what I do is I chop wood and I bring it to sell in the market so that I get just enough to feed me, my mother and my sister, and that's it. That's all he gets for the full day. Full day's work. Just a bit of food, like a loaf of bread and a few things for him, his wife, his mother and his sister, that's it. The prince said, he said, what about if I just change your life? He said, how's that, prince? Prince said, what about if I gave you, if I did a favor for you and I made you happy and I gave you enough money that you don't have to work for another day in your life? Allahu Akbar. What are you going to say? Allahu Akbar. But the poor man, the poor woodcutter, didn't say that. The poor woodcutter said, he says, prince, what makes you think that I am not happy? What makes you think that I am not happy? He says, oh prince, please, keep your money to yourself. Keep your palace to yourself, your servants to yourself, this whole place, palace, everything to yourself. I am happy doing what I do because I am free and you are not free. Allahu Akbar. That's now, he knocked the prince's mind. The prince thought, Ya Allah, he's right. I'm imprisoned in the very luxuries Allah gave. I'm enslaved. I am in prison, I can't go out, I'm dependent on all these people, and still I don't have happiness. And this poor man, I try and give him happiness through money, and he says, what makes you think, prince, that I'm not happy? And with that, the poor man walked out. And that brought tears to the prince. He then called his servant. He said, get my things ready. He got a few things ready. He said, don't tell my father, don't tell anyone. He said, I'm leaving the palace. He left the palace. And they say for 20 years, this prince went and he worked for a blacksmith. And he toiled very hard. And he actually became very happy that he's working with a blacksmith and is able to come at the end of his day or in between all his time and is able to offer his salah. That happiness, the freedom Allah gives, the enjoyment Allah gives is more than his whole palace and everything else Allah gave to him. Now my brothers, my sisters, you know, you think that you have made it, you've become Muslim 2.0, whatever that means, right? Your next generation, bravo. I'm in it, I'm with it, you know, I'm silent, I'm with it. That's what you think. You think the whole generation before you are too slow to even understand how smart you are. Wow. Man, you ain't even tasted life yet. Serious. You haven't even tasted life yet. Because you know what's going to happen one day, my friend? One day, you're going to get married. And one day, Allah's going to give you a kid. And the day Allah gives you a child in your hand, or two children in your hand, you're going to look at them and you're going to think, Ya Allah, please don't make these two kids of mine the rebel that I was. Don't make them disobedient like I was disobedient to my mom and dad. Don't make them forget the bounties that you gave them and the favors I'm doing on them. Don't make them grow up like that. The moment you get kids, you know what? From your heart, bottom of your heart, you're going to say, رَبِّ رَحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. Now you ain't got your mom, or you ain't got your dad, or they're not looking after you. And from the bottom of your heart, you're going to say, oh my Lord, have pity and mercy on my parents. Because you can see what now life is about. Life is not about streets. Life is not about, you know, a bit of money. Life is not about drugs. Life is not about girlfriends and boyfriends. Life is not about technology. All that aside, life is responsibility. Life is not a few nights that you enjoy. Life is not about a club. Life is not about your muscles, everything else. You know what? Your muscles start to give up. Your muscles give up. Your eyes give in. Your hair disappears. You become Mr. Bowley. Before you know, slick bruv. One day this way, one day that way, one day cut here, one day this way, that way, step there. I can do what I want, man. When you don't have hair, brother, you're not going to be doing that. You're going to be rubbing it and trying to pull it out. Alhamdulillah, I've got two pieces left here. That's what you're going to be doing, bruv. You know, now you've got so much strength, you can run 2 miles without even stopping. 3 miles you can run. There's going to be a time when you climb the stairs, 3 flights of stairs. Ooh, you know how old were you? You're probably 35, 40. Seriously, you're not even 67, you're 35, 40. 3 flights of stairs, 4 flights of stairs, 1 go. Khomro dorse, got me in the back. Why? Because your back's giving in, your stomach is giving in. You think every 14-year-old just got a belly? You think that's just happened like that? Their digestive system is slower than normal digestive systems. At 25 or 20, you had a whole chicken with a burger on top, and then you look for the wings. Chip stuff down, wedges a few of them on top, walked for a bit outside the shop, came back in, had another half a chicken. Seriously. Allah's given some people ability. Alhamdulillah, the Prophet is young. Then comes a time, he's only 37, 38, maybe 35. He just has half a plate of food. And his belly sticks out.
weeks out. If anything was wrong with you, man, get back in. And he goes and does an exercise, he doesn't go in. He does exercise, he doesn't go in. They're going to think that I'm, you know, I'm stuffing myself. He's not stuffing himself. His digestive system has gone slower. He just digests it slower than what he was when he was in his 20s. You think your body's going to be the same? You think Allah's giving you something to keep it the same? Your looks are gone. You suddenly get bags under your eyes. How did my bags come under my eyes, man? You know your teeth? That looks so brilliant. Yeah? One day someone knocked you and a tooth fell out. You can't put that tooth back in, bro. You have to get a gold tooth or a silver one. Yeah. I'm rich. Hey, you got knocked out, bro. You're rich. You're not stuffing all your gold in your mouth just for nothing. You got knocked out. You start thinking now, you know, you go to the toilet, 20s, you know, you're in your 20s, and you go to the toilet, you don't have to go to the toilet again till Maghrib. In the morning you went, Maghrib you go next time. Whole school, college, you didn't even go once. It's a favorite toilet to hold on here. The toilets are really stinking somehow. And you got the strength to do it, Allahu Akbar. You get to a certain age, you get a certain age, you know the amount of times the toilet flushes with your blood, your whole blood is flushing that many times. You know, you just went 2 hours, go, I didn't drink that much water, then you go again. Then you go a third time, think, man, what's wrong with me? You know why? Because Allah's made your system like that. Your body gets slow. Your soul is not feeling it. You do a bit of journey, you get tired. Before, you know what? If I put you in a car, Allah, you'd go to Manchester and back in the same day and say, give me more. That's what you say. There's some brothers, you know, in the early days, they drive, man, they can drive. Then comes a time when they put him in a car, they say, just get me out after half an hour, I've had enough. They do a little bit of a journey, they get tired. They don't feel like, you know what? Your body gives in. Allah is not, he's not going to keep your eyes the same, your ears the same, your mind the same, everything's going to change. You think for a few years Allah gave you that, you're going to use that to forget Allah? On the Day of Judgment, one of the four questions, before I move my feet and before you move your feet on the Day of Judgment is what? Allah will say what? Ani shababi. Allah will ask about a person's young life. Between 12 and 25, what did you do for me? I gave you all that strength. What did you do for me in that youth? 12 to 25, you know, you go to the age, Allah is. There's a question about life in general, but there's a question specifically about the youth and young age. My friend, you can go out there and you can enjoy and do what you want. If you don't know your Allah, Allah at one point might not be there for you, and that's going to be scary. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith of Tirmidhi, "Ta'arraf ila Allah fi raha, ya'rifka fi shidda." Get to know Allah in your good times. Get to know Allah in your times of luxury. Get to know Allah in your times when you are completely happy. يَعْرِفْكَ فِي الشِّدَّةِ. Then Allah will know you when you're in your time of difficulty. You worship Allah, you do what you're supposed to do, you turn to Allah. When you're okay, when you're healthy, then when something goes wrong, Allah will be there for you, my friend. That's Allah's way, He'll be there for you. Allah hasn't forgotten who you are. You should not forget who Allah is. Allah says what in the Quran? وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. Don't be like those people who have forgotten Allah, and Allah has made them forget themselves. You know the biggest problem is with some people? They forgot Allah. Allah doesn't forget them. No. Allah's not going to forget you. Allah is going to still feed you, but what Allah will do if you're not careful is Allah will make you forget yourself. Now how do you forget yourself? How? Because
my brother, when you go for the dunya, when you go for the world, when you go for your friends, when you go for your technology, when you go for the girls, when you go for the drugs, when you go for whatever is coming your way to make you happy, when you do that, Allah makes you forget the benefits of your own body. Allah makes you forget your own future. Allah makes you forget your own akhirah, where you're going. Allah makes you forget the big times that are coming ahead of you. Allah makes you forget Allah. You're in the middle of enjoyment. And it's only for a temporary amount of time. What happens after that temporary amount of time is, you then suddenly come to realization. That's what I want to tell you, my young friends. I want to invite you to somewhere. Where do I want to invite you? I want to invite you to join all the other young people from the age of 12 to 25. At any moment in that life, they seriously turn to Allah. I want to tell you, I want to give you an invitation. What is that invitation? That invitation is that you are going to have on the Day of Judgment a very special friend, a very close and special friend who is someone who has cared for you a lot as well. And a very special friend who's so special that even Allah will listen to what he says. That his name is Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My friend, you've forgotten your roots perhaps, but don't forget your real roots. Your real roots as a Muslim is Allah and His Messenger. That Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sacrificed his two teeth for you and me. He got bloodied in Taif for you and me. He got called names for you and me to have iman. He became a person from dignity to becoming dishonored, lost all his honor in front of the Quraysh and the people who were his enemies, for you and me to have iman. He became bloodied in several battles or several places, for you and me. He was there in cold nights in a certain war, for you and me. He spent many nights crying for me and you. He was sitting with grief, and Jibreel alayhi had to come to him, for me and you. He is none other than Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhireen, Khatamun Nabiyyin, Shafi'ul Mudhnibin. He is, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the head, the leader of the first and the last. He is the one who will intercede for all the sinners on the Day of Judgment. He is the one Allah will give him Maqam al Mahmuda on the Day of Judgment. A station no other human being can stand up. Only he can stand up. He is the only one when he speaks to Allah, Allah will listen to him on the Day of Judgment. And he will have your company next to him under the arsh of Allah and the throne of Allah. If you make your move and you become a good Muslim, then on the Day of Judgment, Allah will call you to be in his company, Allah. You know what's going to happen? The cool shade, Allah. The moonlit face of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and him looking forward to meeting you, and you are his ummati, you follow his sunnah, and he sees that in your life, and he embraces you, and he gives you the drink of Kawthar, and that drink, he said, whoever takes a sip from there, lam yazma ba'dahu abada, never again in your life ever will you become thirsty ever again. With one single sip. Whiter than milk, sweeter than honey. Whiter than milk, sweeter than honey. And whosoever takes a sip will never become thirsty again. And who else is there? You've got the likes of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam. Go hug him. You've got the likes of Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam. You've got the likes of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, Abu Umar, of Uthman, of Ali, of Talha radiyallahu anhu. You've got the likes of the Sahabiyat, the Sahaba, the people who never had much clothes on this earth, the people who sacrificed this world for the next world, the people who had little to eat, the people who were mocked at, the people who were seen as people who were Sufis,
the people who were seen as little people, who weren't frequent to the masjid, the people who never enjoyed the lives out there in the streets, the people who were left behind in history, the people who were forgotten, those people Allah hasn't forgotten. Those people Allah has put them together. You made your sacrifice for me. Allah says, I will honor you. Al-yawma udhillukum fi dhilli yawma la dhilla illa dhilli. Today I will put you in the shade of my own throne. There is no other shade except for the shade of my throne. All of you under my throne, you will have a place underneath there. Allah. And there's refreshments, enjoyment. With other people sweating outside, you'll be having refreshments. Allah, I invite you to come to there. I'm going to give you one thing before we finish. Adhan is 56. I'm going to give you a quick thing before we finish. That my brothers, my sisters, to get close to Allah, to break away from what you're in at the moment, to come to this pathway, you've got to soften your heart. And I've got to soften my heart. The soil, when it's dry, you can put a seed inside it, it won't grow anything. Soil, you make it wet, moisture, and it's got the sun over it, it will start bringing up a plant. What does our heart need? Our heart needs the dhikr of Allah. Without the dhikr of Allah, the heart becomes hard. It becomes accustomed to the dunya. Its attention is towards the luxuries of this world. It's not towards Allah and the akhirah. To make it to Allah in the Akhirah, you have to put the dhikr, moisten the heart. How do you moisten the heart? And I'm going to give you a quick demonstration. I'm going to ask you in the next 5 minutes. We're going to do a bit of dhikr, and I want everyone to join me in this. And anyone who's going to say to me, the bidah you. Go to the internet. I'm going to talk there's Salafi versus Sufi and Bidah. So please listen to the 3 hours and what is Bidah and what is not Bidah, please look over there. Here's just one demonstration. You can do dhikr at home however you like. But I'm going to ask you, when I tell you to close your eyes, you're going to have no past, no future. So you're going to forget your entire past and forget the entire future. And there's only you and Allah, that's it. That's who exists. You and Allah in the present time. Your eyes closed and you're going to follow what I say. And as I do the dhikr, just carry on doing it with me. Carry on doing it with me. We're just going to remember him, that's all. Are you ready for this?
Yes.
So after 3, you will close your eyes and I will start dhikr, you will start with me. 1, 2, 3. Brothers, please join in. All of you join in. After 3. 1, 2, 3. Allah, 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 Allah. You gave me my hearing, you gave me my seeing, you gave me my walking, you gave me my talking, you gave me my life. You gave me breathing, Allah, 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 Allah. If I spend all my life in sujood for you, I will never be able to pay you back for the few gifts that you've given to me. Allah, 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 Allah. At this moment, none of my family can help me. No one can be at my aid. No friends can be there for me. All my friends are aside. No one can help me. No doctor can help me. No surgery can help me. No hospital can help me. No pill can help me. No medicine can help me. The only one that can help me is Allah.
Allah, 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 Allah,
go to my grave, they wash my body. Oh Allah, they put the janazah cloth over my body. Oh Allah, I see this cloth over me. Oh Allah, they carry me over their shoulders. Oh Allah, they put me in my grave. Oh Allah, they put the soil over me. Oh Allah, it's turned to darkness forever. Oh Allah, I'm deep inside. Oh Allah, they take my wealth, they take everything I had. Oh Allah, I come back to you and no one's going to be here with me except Allah.
Allah, 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 Allah.
I raise my head from the grave. I start walking naked with all the people towards you. Oh Allah, the money that I had is not going to help me today. The fame that I had is not going to help me today. Oh Allah, the thing that I had, the technology has wasted my life. Oh Allah, the whole life I had was a mirage. Oh Allah, I come to you only with the deeds that I've got. And oh Allah, my mother is going to be questioned today. My father is going to be questioned. My friends are going to be questioned today. I am going to be questioned today. I have no one to help me today except Allah.
Allah, 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 Allah.
Oh Allah, I wasted my life in the earth. Oh Allah, I had wished I had done more dhikr of yours. Oh Allah, I wish I was close to you. Oh Allah, so many gifts you gave to me, but I was such a wretched soul. Oh Allah, will you forgive me? Oh Allah, it is too late to ask forgiveness from you. Oh Allah, I remember the times that I was close to you and you were close to me. Oh Allah, I wish I had left my friends. I wish I had left my life. I wish I had left everything. I wish I only was in your ibadah my whole life. Oh Allah, you are calling me right now. Oh Allah, you are calling me right now. Oh Allah, have mercy on me. Because today nobody can help me. Nobody can forgive me except
Allah, 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 Allah.
Open your eyes, brothers. Does this take you out of the world? Yes or no? Put your hands up. If you felt that you are not here for a moment, you know, you summarize Allah, you remembered your akhirah for a bit, put your hands up. No. This is important for you to do. One more minute to the brothers, one more minute. Say your dhikr in a way when you're together, silent, to yourself, in secrecy, in darkness, you and Allah only, kind of calling him, La ilaha illallah, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, just Allah, 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 rescue me, help me, you're the one I need. And then Allah will make you come out of the mess you're in and you will find the path there. Bi-idhnillah. Jazakumullah khair wa akhir da'wana. Alhamdulillah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.